Good morning, Northside family. My name is Jim. I'm one of the pastors on staff here, and it's an honor to be with you guys. It's always an honor to be on this stage and be able to chat with you. As you're coming in to find seats here, we are just welcoming you. We're so excited about the service today. Whether you are online or you're in the room, we just are honored to have you here. And specifically for those of you who are relatively new to Northside, we're really glad that you're here. And if you've yet to connect with us over in the family room, we'd invite you guys to do that. If you go through these doors into that carpeted lobby on the right-hand side, you'll see the living room. You'll find some volunteers there and some staff there that would love to help you out and help you take your next step. And we'd love for you guys to do that. We'd also invite you, if you don't want to fight the crowd on your way out today, if you want to just, you know, chill in your seat and maybe text, you can text CONNECT to 81212, thank you, 81212, to get connected in that way, and we'll start a bit of a chat with you on text. We'd love to do that with you as well. So in general, we just want to connect with you and make ourselves known and get to know you a little bit. In addition to that, this is week one of six on a new series. We're going to be in the book of Colossians for those 6 weeks. Off the Rails is the title. And what we're doing here is we're just talking, we're acknowledging that our lives are sometimes off the rails. Are yours? Anyone? Thank you for being honest in the front row. Okay, yeah, our lives are off the rails, and Colossians has some great information for us. We're going to be there today and then for the next 5 weeks, really trying to understand how to center our lives in Christ. It's going to be fantastic. Now, there's something we want to talk about today, and we rarely do this, but we're going to talk about one specific ministry for a little while, and that's Kids Side Ministry. Any fans of our Kids Side Ministry here? I was kind of thinking so. I wish they were hearing that right now, but here's the deal. Kids Side is great. We've got great staff. We've got great volunteers. Because of your generosity over the last few years, we've got great facilities, freshly remodeled. Everything's fantastic. Can you feel what's coming? There's a but here. We need more volunteers, and we were exposed a little bit last week. We need some more volunteers because we've got more and more kids. We got more and more opportunities, and I asked the staff, how short are we on volunteers? 25. We've got hundreds of volunteers, but we need 25 more to step up because we got these little kiddos that want to grow in their faith. They want to know Jesus. They want to know an adult that they can trust and follow, and we got to find ways to do that well, church. And so here's the deal. We've got that need of 25 spots, and we also have over here a calling. And some of you have been sitting for a while, not sure where you're going to engage, where you're going to invest. But if we can pair that need with your calling, it's going to be fantastic. And so for some of you, you're kind of stirred in that already. I'd invite you to go out to the living room after the service, and there'll be a kid side pastor there to talk with you and help you connect in that way. And again, if you can't make it through that crowd right now, you could also go to our digital bulletin on our website, and we can get information there and start that process. But we'd love to see those 25 roles filled by the end of this weekend, because we got some great ministries happening. We got great kiddos. They need great care. Make sense? All right, thanks, guys. So in addition to that, we've got our offering. We talk about this every week. You know the ways to give. They're listed there, and most of you are doing such a great job with that. Collectively, we are doing such a great job there. We are on budget. We're doing well. This is simply a demonstration of our trust in Jesus. We give of our resources. We say, this is yours. This is our offering. And it's powerful to see the church being the church in that. We not only meet the needs that are here, but we meet the needs that are in this community, in the region, and even internationally. There's so many good things happening because of your sacrificial giving. So we simply want to say thank you for that. And we also want to remind you that this is a time this weekend for the Give Project. And the Give Project, we celebrated this 2 months ago where we gave and we said, of the change in your pockets, a couple dollars here, a couple dollars there, put those in the offering boxes. We give this to a ministry we don't even know is coming yet. It's a partner with us to impact beyond us. And you guys did that 2 months ago and you crushed it. We get to look at that and celebrate that with a video in just a second, but we're going to ask you to do the same thing today. Give some of the cash that you have. Maybe it's $2 or $3, a $5 bill. Every cash contribution that we get in those boxes is going to be put together and given as a gift to a ministry partner, and we get to surprise them and bless them. Here's a great example.
So Refuge International is a nonprofit that serves churches in Greater Louisville. And our goal is to see that every immigrant in Greater Louisville has a Christian friend. And so we partner with churches to love refugees and immigrants. And a lot of what that looks like is providing ministry opportunities for the local church so that they can meet refugees and immigrants personally and engage them in ministry. It really is all in the hope that these activities, which aren't much in and of themselves, but we hope they distill into real friendships that last over time so that people celebrate birthday parties together and holidays, and that they hear about Jesus. I mean, that's the end hope. There are many churches that are in increasingly diversifying neighborhoods that immigrants are nowhere on their radar. As I look to the future and I think about what I feel God calling us to and what I hope we're able to do is to be a tool in God's hands to awaken the church and help them engage, you know, more and more refugees and immigrants, and that it'll reach a point where the church doesn't look at them as a ministry, but they see, oh, this is what heaven is going to look like someday. Our church should look differently because heaven looks that way. And that's really the hope. And maybe someday work ourselves out of a job when churches across Greater Louisville don't speak all the same language, don't look the same, but they have truly incorporated, you know, nations into their own membership. Whoa! Wow. It is $12,430.49. I wasn't expecting that much. So thank you, Northside. This will allow us to serve over 250 plus volunteers, people that have served, are serving, will serve with us from over 50 different churches across Greater Louisville from different denominations. This money given to Refuge like this really does go a long way to a lot of different churches, enabling a lot of different churches and a lot of different volunteers to get a first taste, an ongoing taste of ministry to refugees and immigrants. Thank you.
Amen. Yeah, don't you just love to see it, Northside? We are just so incredibly grateful to see the Lord at work in our community through stories just like this. And like we were talking about earlier, we want to invite you to be a part of something exactly like that. Any cash offerings that you give today will be put towards our next give project, and we cannot wait to see where the Lord will pour out his blessing next and share that story with you all next time. But for right now, we get to join together in a time of worship, in a time of praise and declaration where we get to say, Lord, we want to see exactly this. We want to see more of you, less of us, more of your presence, more of your kingdom come and your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So if you're ready to declare that today, why don't you stand and worship with us?
Your kingdom come, of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. You're worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
I will build my
Amen. Amen. Please be seated. We have a chance to sing this song, to declare this. It's a declaration. It's a prayer. And the question is it an active reality in our lives? Are we actively building that kind of life that is focused on this gospel, this good news, this Christ, the solid rock on which we stand? And as we come to a time of communion, I've got just a few verses I'd like us to think about and just to reflect for a little bit. And we're in Colossians chapter 1. And listen to the grandeur, listen to the expanse of God's work, his sovereign reign, in verses 19 and 20 of chapter 1 of Colossians. For God in all his fullness was pleased to live in Christ, and through him, God reconciled everything to himself. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth by means of Christ's blood on the cross. Everything in heaven and on earth. And he does this. He makes peace through a gruesome and bloody cross. It's a strange concept. It's a holy incredibility, but that's what God does. He knows that we're far from him, and he puts the punishment on his son. And he makes peace everywhere in that way. And then it gets personal. The next verse says this, and this includes you who were once far away from God. You were his enemies, separated from him by your evil thoughts and actions, yet now he's reconciled you to himself through the death of Christ in the physical body. As a result, he has brought you into his own presence, and you are holy and blameless as you stand before him without a single fault. Isn't that good news? Without a single fault, we stand before the King of Kings and Lord of Lords because of the work of Christ. Now, I'm not oblivious to this. I came in with my own baggage today, and I've got a cumulative pile of baggage of those actions and thoughts that could leave me absolutely blamed. But I get to stand in Christ, and so do you. And that's incredible news. That's why we pause for communion. And so you've got the elements there, and I want you just to think about this for a second. Reflect with me on that incredible truth that we get to somehow stand without a single fault. After you reflect on that, remember the cost that was paid, his work, his finished work on the cross. And then the hardest part, rest in that. Rest in his finished work. It's not your work. It's his work done for you. Isn't that great news? Reflect on that and take when you're ready. Bless you, church.
As we sing, let's behold the King of Kings, the worthy Lamb who was slain. Down at your feet,
at your altar to seek your face, broken and poured out without restraint, in full abandon before my King. Here I surrender my
sacrifice. Lord, we're overwhelmed that we can come before you as believers, blameless before you because of what Christ did. May we never take that for granted. May we never overlook that. Lord, we continue to invite your Spirit to move in this place this morning as we gather, as we sing your praise, as we hear your word, do a work in our hearts. We give you praise. praise, glory, and honor. In Jesus' name we say together, amen. Well, hey, you can take a seat, and we get to celebrate some life change right now together through baptism.
Okay, I want to introduce you to Sayla Ray and her father, Jim, who drove down here from Peoria to be here for his precious daughter's baptism. Sayla, do you believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God?
Yes, I do.
Have you received him as your Lord and Savior?
Yes, I have.
Okay, we're going to baptize you in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, representing death with Christ as you go under and resurrection of Christ as you come up to live a new life in Christ. Bend your knees.
This is Emmy. She has been in Callie and I's small group with NSM for a few years. I'm so excited that her brother came today because she started coming to small group because her brother had gotten baptized and he'd been like, Emmy, you gotta come. And so now Emmy has really taken just ownership of her faith and she's been inviting others to come. And so I'm really excited for this step for her today. So I have a few questions for you, Emmy. Do you believe that Jesus is the Son of God?
Yes.
Do you believe that he died on the cross and rose again on the third day for the forgiveness of your sins?
Yes.
All right. Have you taken him as your Lord and Savior?
Yes.
Okay. It's because of this that I get to baptize you in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
As we begin our new series, Off the Rails, this weekend, we want to take some time to slow down and reflect. There's a Greek word in the Bible, pneuma. It is used both to refer to the Holy Spirit and to breath or breathing. Recent scientific study has found a strong link between controlling our breathing and the calmness of our bodies. I certainly don't think it's an accident that these two things are associated in the Bible. By calming our breathing and setting our focus on the Holy Spirit, we can turn down the things that are vying for our attention and begin to focus on the promptings of God. Let's take some time to practice this. Right now, you can choose to close your eyes. If you're able, begin to take slower, deeper breaths and begin to focus on the Holy Spirit's presence. Now, while maintaining this focus, begin to think on this question and ask the Holy Spirit to help reveal the answer. Does it ever feel like your life is going off the rails? Open your eyes and reflect on today's scripture. Life is off the rails, following Jesus keeps us on track. And let's dive into today's message and discover how following Jesus gives us new life.
Does it ever feel like your life is off the rails? It's an interesting phrase. It's an idiom, which means it has two meanings. An idiom means that there's a literal meaning, but then there's also a figurative meaning. And so the literal meaning of this phrase, off the rails, comes from railroad culture. It comes from train carts. And what would happen is these rail carts would be on the rails, they'd be on their track, and then something would happen that would cause them to go off the rail. And then there'd be one of two things that would happen. Either it would halt the journey, it would stop, or sometimes they'd be so much off the rails that it would divulge into a full train wreck. And you would have this off the rails moment. That's the literal meaning. Now, the figurative meaning is a little bit different, but it's the same kind of concept. It's been hijacked by culture. And in fact, the way that the English Oxford Dictionary describes it is this. It's used to describe anything which is no longer on its expected course or has become completely uncontrollable. And listen, there's a big difference there. All right, because when we hear the phrase off the rails, maybe the first thing you think is over here is that train wreck. You're like, does my life ever feel like a train wreck? Some of you might be thinking, yeah, maybe it does. But some of you are thinking, no, my life's not a train wreck, but listen to the difference. It's when something's not on the expected course all the way to when something is completely uncontrollable. And so does life ever feel off the rails? Let me explain it like this. When I was getting ready to propose to my wife, Danielle, I had everything planned out to a T. I knew when I was going to do it. I knew how I was going to do it. Specifically, it had to be January 1st. The stuff I was going to say needed to be on January 1st, and things were coming together really well, and I had everything ready to go for January 1st except for one small detail, the ring. And it's not that I didn't buy the ring. I had it. I was ready to go. It just hadn't come in yet. And so December 25th hits, no ring yet. December 27th hits, no ring yet. December 30th hits, no ring yet. It's December 31st, and I'm getting nervous. And I'm like, I have to do this tomorrow. I'll buy a ring pop if I have to, right? Like, I'm going to make sure I propose on January 1st. And finally, at 2 p.m. in the afternoon on December 31st, I get a text from the ring shop. And they say, Jacob, your ring came in. We're so excited for you. This is going to be amazing. You can come pick it up. But here's the deal. We actually close at 3 p.m. and we're closed all day tomorrow. And it's 2 p.m. And normally that wouldn't have been an issue. I just could have gotten up and gone. But the thing is, I was in the movie theater across the street with my entire family and Danielle, my now wife, watching a movie at 2 p.m. when I got this text. And so I'm like, what in the world am I supposed to do? And so I was forced to do the only thing I could do. I leaned over to Danielle and I said, I have to go to the bathroom. And I stood up. And I walked out of that theater, and I walked out of that building, and I got in my car, and I drove to the ring shop. And here's the deal. I got to the ring shop, and they're, like, showing me, and they're kind of asking me my plans, and we're having a good old time. Before I realize it, I have been gone an hour from this movie. And I texted my parents what was going on. I'm like, hey, just so you know, like, I'm going to be doing this. And so they're not worried, but Danielle's blowing my phone up. She's like, are you alive? What is happening? Are you okay? And so I finally get back to the movie theater. And you know, maybe you've been there before. Maybe you haven't. But when you have the ring, you just don't act normal. Like, once you have it, you're just kind of like, okay, like, I got to act normal. Got to be cool. And so I sit down, and I'm, like, nervous and sweating and smiling. And she's looking at me like, do we need to go to the hospital? Like, what is going on? Now, here's the deal. In that moment, life was not on its expected course. I wouldn't say that it was a train wreck. Like, things were going to happen. I was going to propose. And even the proposal the next day, when it was off the rails. It was not what I expected. That's a story for another day. But sometimes life is off the rails, not because it's a train wreck, but because we were expecting it to go this way. And it goes this way. So let me ask you one more time. Does it ever feel like life is off the rails? You thought, you know, it's May. You're a senior in high school. And you thought by now you would have that college acceptance letter and you'd be able to say, here's where I'm going. It's going to be awesome. But instead, you're still waiting. And you're thinking, I just thought I'd have this by now. I thought I'd be good to go. You thought at this point, this month, you'd be graduating. You'd finally be able to walk across the stage, whether it be high school or whether it be college, whether it could be whatever, medical school. And you thought, man, I'm going to be finally graduating. My life's going to get started. But you haven't. You're not. And it's just not what you expected. You thought by this time you'd have the house. You thought by this time you'd have the apartment, or at least the bigger house. You thought by this time you'd have the forever home. But you don't. You thought by this time God was going to answer that prayer, exactly the way that you asked it. We believe in Jesus. We pray. We say, God, aren't you going to do this? Aren't you going to answer the prayer? I've asked you for months now, and he hasn't. You thought that you would have kicked that addiction by now, but you haven't. You thought that pain that you have, or that sickness, or maybe the chronic pain of someone you love, or the sickness of someone you love, that would be healed right now. God's the great physician, right? That should be gone away right by now. It's not. You thought you'd be married by now. You're not. You thought you'd still be married. You're not. You thought your kids would just be in a better spot. Whatever that means for you, you just thought, man, I thought they would just be a little more advanced. Or I thought they'd be more okay, and it just feels like they're not, and you don't know what to do, and you're not okay with that. You thought you could retire by now, but you can't. Maybe I've had this conversation with people who are 20, and I've had this conversation with people who are 60. You just thought by this time in life, you would have things more together. And you thought by the time you were 20 or 30 or 40 or 50 or 60 or 70 or 80, at this point in your life, that things would be more ready to go. You'd have your ducks in a row, but they just aren't. And you're not where you expected. You're not where you hoped. And life just feels off the rails. Here's the deal. We have one of two things we can do. We could talk today about how to avoid that. Okay, how do you make sure life never goes off the rails? But I don't think we can do that. Because sometimes we can't always control that. So what we have to do today is ask the question, when life is off the rails, what do we do? We can't just try to avoid it our whole lives because it's always going to be happening. Things are just going to happen. But when life is off the rails, what do we do? And the good news is this is not just my TED Talk to tell you about my thoughts. The Bible goes before us. And so I'm going to invite you to turn back to the book of Colossians, chapter 1. If you have your Bible, if you have a phone with access to the internet, now is the time, Colossians 1. And as you're doing that, I think a little bit of context is going to be important here because the book of Colossians, if you don't know this, is actually a letter written by a man named Paul to a church in the city of Colossae. And so when he is writing this, when Paul's writing this letter, he is doing it to a people with a purpose. And I think that's important that we remember that in the Bible, that when we read these, some of these books of the Bible, they are letters to a people with a purpose. And the specific purpose of this letter, it's perfect, is Paul is writing to them, this church that is doing really well as a church, by the way. But there's this teaching, there's two groups of teaching there that are going to start to encourage them to go off the rails. It's this nonsense teaching and on two different sides that are trying to encourage them to go off track. And Paul writes this whole letter to say, hey, stay on track. Here is how you stay on track. In fact, what he's really doing is saying, here's how you don't go off the rails. And so we get a front row seat to what the Bible says about what we do when life is off the rails. Colossians 1, verse 22. Here's how it starts. Yet now he has reconciled you to himself. This is God, by the way. He has reconciled you to himself through the death of Christ in his physical body. As a result, he has brought you into his own presence, and you are holy and blameless as you stand before him without a single fault. I think this is really interesting because in this moment, like what we'd expect Paul to do is say, all right, when life has the opportunity to go off the rails, when things can start to go a little bit haywire, you would expect him to kind of give you a play-by-play of what to do. Here's the first step. You're going to set a SMART goal, all right? Make sure it's specific and measurable, and you're going to do this afterwards, and you're going to make sure you practice. He doesn't do that. He gives them this. He reminds them of the most foundational truth in their life, the gospel. He says, don't forget that Jesus came to earth and died on the cross for your sins, and now we are reconciled to God. We are holy and blameless in his sight. He says, this is how we're going to start. And just imagine really quickly if you and I were in a counseling meeting, and we were sitting down, and I was kind of telling you all my problems, and I'm sitting there, and I'm like, and then I didn't have the ring yet, and so I had to go to the bathroom, fake go to the bathroom, and I'm telling you all my problems, all right? And you look back at me, and you said, well, did you ever think about the gospel during that? I would be like, this isn't helpful. Like, why are you telling me about this right now? I love the gospel. The gospel is great. Thank you so much for this. But it can almost sound tone deaf in the moment. But for some reason, Paul starts here and he says, don't forget about the gospel. And here's why. He starts in 22 and he finishes this thought in 23. He says, but you must continue to believe this truth and stand firmly in it. Don't drift away from the insurance you received when you heard the good news. The good news has been preached all over the world, and I, Paul, have been appointed as God's servant to proclaim it. And he says, here is the most foundational truth that changes everything in your life. It is Jesus. It is the gospel. And he says, if you want to stay, if you want to keep on track, if you don't want to go off the rails, here's what you can do. You can believe it. You can stand firmly in it, and you don't drift from it. And he doesn't give us this four-step plan. He says, just, it's the gospel. And this is so important because this matters to every single person in this room. Does not matter what you think about Jesus. It matters to you. First, let me just address non-believers in the room. So if you're a follower of Jesus, if you're a Christian, you get 3 minutes off. Read your Bible or give me an amen every once in a while. I don't know. What are you going to do? Non-believers in the room. Number one, we're so glad you're here. So glad you're here. Does it ever feel like your life is off the rails? And if you're a non-believer, maybe you're here because life does feel off the rails and you're looking for something. And every decision that you make just feels like it ends you up in the wrong spot. And so you're looking for some type of direction, something to get you through another way. You're looking for some type of thrill or some type of feeling, because really what you're looking for is escape. You want something more in life. You want something different because you don't like the reality you're living, and so you're just looking for escape. Does it ever feel like you're looking for an internal peace that feels increasingly impossible? There's no chance that you can have peace on earth, but you're looking for it somewhere. Can I offer you what I think is the best advice that Paul's giving for someone who does not believe in Jesus and their life is off the rails? Verse 23, believe this truth. If you do not follow Jesus and life feels off the rail, I cannot make it simpler. Believe this truth that Jesus is the Lord, that he is our Savior, and that following him is the best way to live life. Colossians 1, chapter 15, or verse 15, Paul has this moment where he puts Jesus in the perfect light. Just listen to this. I'm going to let it speak for itself. Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He existed before anything was created and is supreme over all creation. For through him, God created everything in the heavenly realms and on earth. He made the things we can see and the things we can't see, such as thrones, kingdoms, rulers, and authorities in the unseen world. Listen to this. Everything was created through him and for him. He existed before anything else, and he holds all creation together. Christ is also the head of the church, which is his body. He is the beginning, supreme over all who rise from the dead. So he is first in everything. For God, in all his fullness, was pleased to live in Christ, and through him, God reconciled everything to himself. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth by means of Christ's blood on the cross. That is the Jesus we follow. And if you do not believe in him and life is off the rails, believe that truth. I truly believe it will change everything for you. I'm not going to tell you right now that once you follow Jesus, everything's going to be exactly what you expected. Nothing ever is going to go wrong in your life again. But Jesus came to give us life and life to the full. And following him is the best way to live life. Believe this truth. Now, Christians, you're back in. Bible's down. All right, make sure you're paying attention. Here's why you need to back in, because if you're a non-believer and you start to follow Jesus, know that there's still moments where life feels off the rails. And the reason for that, Paul addresses it, is because there's this idea of the drift that happens. That word, that phrase, don't drift, it's the only time in the New Testament that we get that specific phrase, and it's the idea of moving away. And this is just a universal truth. You'll never drift into health in your life. When I'm on like a diet or workout plan, there's never been a moment where I've drifted into a six-pack of abs. That's just never, it's never happened. I've never woken up and been like, what in the, oh God, right? Like, that's never happened. It's never happened before. I have drifted into many ice cream cartons in my life, though. It just happens. It's crazy. When in your marriage, you just don't drift into being a better husband or to a better wife. You don't drift into being a better grandparent. You don't drift into being a better boss. I have never also drifted. Maybe you have drifted into a better, deeper, more devoted follower of Jesus. I've never drifted into that. Never walked into my kitchen and tripped and hit my Bible and it's accidentally open to the perfect page and I sit down and somehow I land with my hands crossed and I'm like, what? Like that's, I don't drift into that. It takes intentionality and it takes work. And Paul says, do not drift. In fact, the language there is even more specific. It's do not move away from the hope you have in Jesus. Don't drift away from this incredible truth of the gospel that you have. And here, listen, this is important because it is so easy to drift. It does not matter if you have been a follower of Jesus for 10 minutes or if you've been a follower of Jesus for 50 years, it is incredibly tempting to drift. In the moments where life is an uncontrolled mess, and for you, off the rails means a train wreck, it is easy to drift. And we take our eyes off of Jesus and we take our eyes to the mess and we start to try to do things, we start to figure things out, and before we know it, we have drifted. It is easy to drift in the moment of just little disappointment where things were going good, things were on the right track, and then you have one hiccup and you thought, God, I thought you were for me. God, I thought we were in this together. I pray to you, I do what you're supposed to do, and then you disappointed me here and you start to question, is this even worth it? And maybe the scariest one is this. It is easy to drift when things are going really, really well. Because all of a sudden, we stop relying on Jesus. And we forget our need for him. And when things are going well, when our job is taking off and family life is good and just our personal life is, we're nailing it and just everything is going on the right track, it can be really, really easy to drift away from him. And Paul says this, don't drift. Our question today, we simply ask this, when life is off the rails, what do we do? I gotta be honest, I tried to overcomplicate it all week. I tried to make up some cool rhyme or have some sermon points. It's like the four P's of not drifting. That's not it. It's simple. When life is off the rails, don't drift from Jesus. This is what he's saying in Colossians chapter 1. When life is off the rails, do not move away from the hope you have in Jesus. Hold on to him. Don't move. In those moments of disappointment, where what you had hoped for and what is are completely different, hold on to Jesus. Do not move away from him. In the moments where life is complete chaos, you don't know even which way is up in that moment. Don't drift from Jesus. Don't move away from the hope you have in him. And when life is off the rails, don't drift from Jesus. Stay with him. And right now, what we could do is I could be like, all right, there's your big point for the day. Don't drift from Jesus. All right, I can make a joke like, and don't drift in the parking lot, whatever that looks like. But we have to ask this question. Okay, how do I not drift? How do I stay with him even when life gets difficult, when life is off the rails? And the good news for us is that Paul tells us. If you're with me in the Bible, Colossians 2, verses 6 and 7, it says this, "And now, just as you accepted Christ Jesus as your Lord, you must continue to follow him." Pause for a second. Do you notice he does this again? It's the same format as 1:23, where he says, hey, like you believe him, now stand firm in it. He says it again right here. You accepted him, and now you must continue to follow him. There's something to that. He's really hammering us home on not leaving Jesus. But then he tells us how specifically in verse 7. Let your roots grow down into him, and let your lives be built on him. Then your faith will grow strong in the truth you were taught, and you will overflow with thankfulness. If you're a highlighter, underliner, or circler, that phrase, let your roots grow down into him. Now's the time. That's the one. This is one of my favorite scriptures in the Bible, just to hold on to for me. Because what Paul's doing here is he's mixing metaphors. He gives an agricultural one where he says, let your roots grow down. And then he says, so that you can have this industrial metaphor of having your lives built up. But it all depends on these roots here. And really what he's saying is this, is that if you don't want to drift from Jesus, then you have to be rooted in Jesus. If you don't want to move away from Jesus, then you have to find a way to stay in Jesus. You have to have your roots down in him. But maybe you're thinking right now, all right, cool. Roots are like plants. And they grow down, like that's a really cool metaphor. But this word is so much deeper. It's this Greek word, rizoo. And when you look at what it means, it's this idea of rendering firm, or to fix, or to establish, or to cause a person or thing to be thoroughly grounded. It's that idea of when you're packing something into a pickup truck. You've been here before. You're moving something and you're putting all this stuff into a pickup truck and you're shoving it way too full and you're kind of worried like, all right, is it gonna like move around a little bit? And then you pull out the ratchet straps and you throw that ratchet strap over and you fix it into that hook and you put it over here and you start going, whoosh, 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 this is my ratchet strap. You do this and it tightens down and you throw the other one on there and you tighten it down really, really, really tight. And then you have that moment where you just kind of go like this, that ain't going anywhere. You know, you've been there. That's what it means to be rooted, though. Like, you've seen that imagery in your life before, but take it to your spiritual life. That in moments where things are shaky and things are weird, that Paul says, man, you need to be so rooted in Jesus that you can essentially pat yourself and say, man, I'm not going anywhere. It doesn't matter how crazy things get because I am established, I am fixed, I am firm in him. Take this to those examples that we talked about earlier. In that moment, when you've been praying for something for months, and the Lord just isn't answering it in the way that you expected or wanted him to, you can think of, you have two options. Number one, you can start to question God's goodness. Man, is he really good? He's not answering my prayer like I wanted to. Is he even real? Is he even gonna exist? Is he even gonna talk to me? Or you can be so rooted, so firmly fixed to him that instead of questioning his goodness, you start to look for his goodness in your life, even in the midst of a bad time, because you know it is inherent to who he is, that he is good. You are rooted in him. In that moment when you thought that life would just be in a better spot than it is, you got options. You can start to think of yourself as a failure. Man, because I'm not where I want to be, I am not who I want to be, I am worthless. Or you can be so rooted, so established with Jesus that you know you have value because of whose you are. When you're in the middle of that sickness or that pain, or you're watching someone you love or know go through that sickness or that chronic pain, or maybe it's not even physical pain, but it's a relational pain that you're going through, you can think, man, God's abandoned me. Or you can be so rooted that you know that even in the moments it doesn't feel like it, he is still with you. And if you don't want to drift from Jesus, you have to be rooted in Jesus. My wife and I, Danielle, we went to Kings Island once. We're big roller coaster people. And we get there, and we're going on all these roller coasters, and we get to this one, and it's just one of those crazy ones. I think I've got a picture of it that you can see. It's one of these. That's actually the exact roller coaster that we were going on. And so you can see it's one of those ones that your legs hang down, and like there's corkscrews, and you go upside down. It's just crazy. One of those crazy ones. And so we're getting in line, and we're excited about it. We're like, man, we can't wait for this roller coaster. And we finally get to the front of the line. We get seated. I mean, you go through all the normal stuff. You sit down and you pull the lap bar over yourself and you buckle your seatbelt in and they come through and they check everything and it's great. And we're going up this hill and there's just that feeling when you're going up a roller coaster hill that you're just like, yeah, right? Like, this is good. I'm excited about this. I cannot make this up. This is a true story. I had to ask Daniel to make sure I wasn't crazy. As we are going up the roller coaster hill, we are almost to the top. Danielle's seatbelt buckle unbuckles, and her lap bar completely loses pressure. And we're like sitting there. I mean, what do you do in that moment? Like, what? Like, I'm sitting there looking at this, looking at the roller coaster about to go on, thinking, I'm about to watch my wife go off the rails, literally. Like, this is not going to go well for us. And I don't know how to handle this situation. She doesn't know how to handle the situation. And so we start praying out loud. Like, the people around us must be like, it's not that scary. Like, it's just a roller coaster. You'll be fine. But I mean, I don't know what to do. I just stick my hand into her lap bar, and I hold it as tight as I can. And long story short, she's alive. And so she, like, we made it through the roller coaster, but we go up and down, and I'm sitting there as hard as I can, and my arm is going numb. I'm just like, oh my gosh, this cannot be happening right now. This is horrible. This is the scariest moment of my entire life. I asked her, I said, like, do you remember this? And she said, yes, everything you're remembering is exactly right. And we got to the end, and we had gone upside down. We'd corkscrewed. We'd gone left, right. We'd done everything. And we looked at each other. And I remember it was the least amount of fun I've ever had on a roller coaster, which is ironic because it was the biggest thrill I've ever had on a roller coaster. But the difference in my seat and her seat, and her seat, every hill that we were going on, every twist, every turn, every loop, every corkscrew, there is the fear that she was going to fall out because she wasn't buckled in. She wasn't rendered firm. She wasn't fixed. She wasn't established. The difference with me, there was never a moment during that ride that I thought, oh boy, this is it. There was never a moment where I thought, I'm not going to make it. This isn't going to happen. Why? Because I was fixed in that seat. I was established. I was rendered firm. I was not going anywhere. And it changed the way we rode the ride. Do you see the similarity? When life is off the rails, don't drift from Jesus, but be rooted in him. Be so fixed and firmly secure in him that you know no matter what happens, no matter what twist or what turn or how life goes upside down, you're not going anywhere. You're with Jesus. You're so firmly rooted in him that even when life around you isn't okay, you know you'll be okay. Two practices to do this well if you want to be rooted to Jesus so you don't drift from Jesus. These are simple. You've heard us say them before, but they work. They're so powerful. The first one is this. If you want to be rooted to Jesus, you have to devote yourself to Scripture. If we want to know who Jesus was and what Jesus said and what he stood for and what he was about, the best way to do that is Scripture, is to read what he said and read what he did and to know him well, to know his thoughts. I found out this week, our good friend Matt Reagan, he told me that the book of Colossians only takes 13 minutes to read front to back. What if over the next 6 weeks, once a week, you just read the book of Colossians to remind yourself of what to do when life feels off the rails. Maybe you're not there yet and you're thinking, I want to be devoted to Scripture, but I don't even know where to start, and that's a lot. A whole book feels like a lot for me. I would encourage you to go to the Gospels. Read one chapter a day and ask yourself, what is it asking of me? And then do that. That is devoting yourself to Scripture. That is a beautiful place to start. And I'm just going to tell you right now, when you start small, your appetite for Scripture will grow. Second thing, to root yourself well, practice. Devote yourself to prayer. This is not groundbreaking. This is not earth-shattering, but it's so simple. It's powerful. Devote yourself to prayer. If you want to be rooted to Jesus, devote yourself to prayer. We need to have a relationship with him. And that comes in speaking to him and letting him speak to us. What does this look like for you? Maybe this is just starting a habit for the first time ever of prayer in your life. It could be as simple as when you get in the car on the way to work. Maybe it's as soon as you drop the kids off at school, you turn off the radio, and for 5 minutes as you're driving, you just have a conversation with the Lord. Tell him how great he is. Present your request to him. We are supposed to do that. And then spend some time in silence just listening to what he has to say to you. These two simple practices are the start of rendering yourself firm in Jesus. And when we have our roots down in him, we can build our lives on him. We just sang it. We're about to sing it again. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. When life feels off the rails, don't drift from Jesus. Be rooted in him. Lord, we love you. God, we pray today specifically that when life is off the rails, we know what to do. And we don't lose it. And we don't lose sight of ourselves or lose sight of you. But God, we do things today to prepare us for then. God, we start to root ourselves now. So when the moments of the twists and the turns of life come, that we are so firmly rendered safe in you, we are so established and fixed in you, we're not going anywhere. God, we don't drift from you because our roots are so deep into you. Lord, thank you for providing a way to root ourselves in you. Thank you for scripture. Thank you for prayer. Thank you for community. Thank you for worship. Thank you for all these gifts that are for us. We are grateful. Lord, help today our words not to be just words, but God, the words that you gave to us in Colossians, they become a way that we live every single day. It is in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's worship together.
Sing this as a declaration before we go.
And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone. And I will not be shaken. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone. And I will not be shaken. Holy, there is no one like you. There is none beside you. Open up my eyes in wonder. Show me who you are and fill me with your heart and lead me in your love to those around me. And I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put my trust in you alone. And I will not be shaken. I will build my life upon your love. It is a firm foundation. I will put
that be our prayer this week. Maybe be rooted in Christ. Hey, if you need prayer, we would love to meet with you in your seats. So stay in your seats. If you need prayer, we'd love to meet with you. The rest of us, God bless you. Walk with Christ. We'll see you next weekend.